day. Another great day. Another great breakthrough. Another great day. Another great breakthrough, to say the least. The progress it continues to be astonishing. As are the trouble, the unraveling of the world continues to be astonishing. We just found out that Greece voted no on their referendum, and so that is going to be reverberating. So, you know, from here on, we are in a race against the unraveling. There's no question about it. Now, I'm aware that there is going to be something drastic happen. We're entering into a drastic time. Now, it doesn't matter what form drasticness takes. Let's use the example of weather. Let's say there's the condition, you find yourself in the condition, it's 130 degrees. You're in Death Valley, it's 130 degrees. Absolutely broiling. This is what? A drastic situation, right? It's drastic. Now let's say you're somewhere in the North Pole, it's minus 130 degrees. Okay. This is drastic. Both situations are characterized by being drastic. They're drastic. So there's a lot of different conditions that can happen, which we would say, you know what, this just feels drastic. I feel it's very drastic. It's the feeling that's important. It doesn't matter what form the situations take on. It's the feeling that is produced, like, wow, this is just drastic. This is the trouble that we're facing. So we don't need to obsess on what is going to happen. We, you know, we're aware that these various trends, and there's so many trends. It's like if you're a meteorologist and you have set up all these weather stations with various instruments to gauge all sorts of measurements, okay, of weather, and you have these thresholds that if the measurement goes above a certain threshold, an alarm goes off, says, wow, this has breached this parameter. This is worthy of an alarm. This is an extreme. So you have all these different measurements that you can take about weather. And if one after the other of these gauges breach the threshold, the alarm threshold, and the alarms go off, and you alarm here, you know, you're very justified as a meteorologist to say, hey, folks, there's a drastic weather system coming. There is a drastic weather system coming. Now, you may not be able to determine exactly where it's going to hit, exactly what the damage is, exactly how it plays out, but you're certainly within your rights to say there's a drastic weather system approaching. How much snow will fall, for instance, you're not sure, right? But you say it's drastic. It's going to be drastic. So we can predict drasticness. We may not be able to predict, you know, minute details of every last thing, but does that really matter? I mean, who is it that says, well, gee, you said that, only 8 feet of snow would fall. You said 8 feet of snow would fall, and actually it was 7 feet, 11 inches, so you were wrong. It wasn't drastic. You know, of course, this is insanity. This is the definition of insanity, of losing sight of the forest because of the trees. Okay, you lose sight of the forest. There's this drastic weather system coming in, and people are saying, "Well, if you don't get it exactly right in every last little parameter that I set up, then that means it isn't drastic." This is a reaction formation based on fear and panic. Okay, so we have to avoid those reaction formations. We're reacting to the drasticness and forming a measurement. That we think that if it doesn't meet these measurements, that means it isn't drastic, so we've somehow magically escaped the drasticness of it. It's like a hurricane. It comes in, and we say, well, the winds could be up to 150 miles an hour, and they turn out to be 149, and then people say, oh, so it's not drastic. You know, I'm perfectly safe here. Didn't reach 150. So it really, you see, this is called a reaction formation. And it's an insane defense system. It's an insane defense system, obviously. And yet we realize we're all subject. It's frightening when people start saying, "Oh, nothing, don't worry." You know, if it these reaction when these reaction formations are in charge, you know, and too many people are talking about this, it can mess with our, you know, clarity. So there is as a very keen sociologist and aware of this world, not only this world but the influence of other worlds upon this world. I have all these different parameters, and I'm aware of what these parameters are, a lot of them. And when they go beyond this alarm threshold, you know, the alarm goes off in my mind. And I'm having so many of these alarms going off right now. And I have to conclude that something drastic is on its way. Something drastic is on its way. And I don't need to know exactly what it is in order to know it's drastic and to take preventative measures. There's certain measures we can take that protect our mind from going into feeling drastic mode, and reaction formations are not one of them. That's like floodwaters, you know, and you say, well, there's going to be a flood, 20 feet of floodwaters, there's only 19 feet 6 inches. Does that mean you sit in your basement and say, I don't have to worry about a flood? That's ridiculous. There's nothing drastic going to happen. Now, of course, that would be an insane fool that does that, right? Obviously, if there's 19 feet 6 inches, your house is going to be flooded and you better be on the roof. Okay? And if you just say, oh, no, nothing's going to happen. If it doesn't, if I don't get the exact details of how much happens, that means nothing is going to happen. This is insanity. And we certainly have the right to not be insane. So, again, the thresholds are triggering alarms all over, I've been pushing myself to an extreme extent, hardly sleeping at all, non-stop spiritual practice all day. I'm exhausted, you know. I'm trying to cross the finish line because I feel something drastic is on the way. And it may be a combination. I mean, you know, it could be just a massive combination of factors, actually, that trigger this feeling like, wow, this is just so drastic. And you feel this is, you know, it reaches a threshold in your mind where you start to unravel and collapse when you're in a drastic situation. If you don't have protection, mental protection, if you're not able to get your mind into a peaceful, calm place, then you're going to be ravaged by this. You feel ravaged by it. Now, I feel I'm in a good place, even though I'm stressed out because just trying to cross the finish line. I feel I'm in a good place, but we're in a race against time here. We're in a race against time. But we're in a very advanced place. Still haven't crossed the finish line. I tried to cross the finish line every day and night. I try to. When I go to bed, I'm not thinking about sleeping. I'm thinking about crossing that finish line. And I'm shaking, exhausted from the effort. But it's what's called for. If you realize something drastic is coming, you're going to try and do everything you can to prepare for it. And not just try to figure out, well, what exactly is it, you know? Hey, you know, well, you know, it's a flood is a flood. You know, the parameters of every parameter doesn't have to be, you know, we don't have to obsess about all the parameters. If it's a big flood, it's a big flood. So we just need to you know, the tools for a calm mind will work with everything. If you have the right tools, it doesn't matter what happens, you'll be able to still have a calm mind. See, no matter what they throw at you. There is a great savagery at work in the world right now. And much like Germany for World War II, you know, the world really thought Adolf Hitler was a wonderful guy, great statesman, great politician, great orator, got things done, had gotten Germany's economy back on its feet, had cured so many social ills. I mean, they just, it's a miracle. They said, this guy's a miracle worker, you know. So politicians can seem to be wonderful people, and people are praising them, giving them Nobel Prizes, and what a wonderful, wonderful job you're doing. Look what happened to Germany, you know, World War II. Look what happened quickly it happened. So this one, people thought this guy, this Hitler's a genius, he's a wonderful guy, a statesman, a leader, great orator. He moved the masses. People adored him. They thought he was just the most, people in Germany thought he was the most wonderful thing that ever happened to Germany. Okay? Look what happened to Germany with World War II. So you don't know, you know, he had a hidden agenda, didn't he? He had an agenda. He had an inner agenda with tremendous ferocity and hate, and yet he seemed to be the nicest guy in the world to most people. Most countries of the world thought, hey, this guy's wonderful. We're so glad Germany has such a great leader. There's only a few voices saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, we're a little nervous about this guy. Okay, so we think everything's fine in the world. And like speaking for Americans, you know, Americans think, oh yeah, everything's fine. Well, you know what? Not necessarily at all. Not necessarily at all. I have absolutely no trust in the leadership of political leadership of America and the social ideologies that they're presenting. Absolutely no trust in it whatsoever. It could turn out to be worse than Hitler, actually. And it could happen very, very fast. Very fast. And the rest of the world say, oh yeah, America, aren't you guys great? And no, not necessarily. Now hopefully it doesn't play out that way, but it's just an example. World War II is an example of how things can unravel with hidden agendas behind the scenes that most people are oblivious to. They're just happy about their standard of living, you know, thinking, oh, sure, things are good. But it's the ideologues, it's the demagogues you have to look out for, it's the great orators you have to look out for. Those are the dangerous ones. Those are the dangerous ones. And you have to look at the friends they have around them. Like if you looked at Hitler, you could see the people he had around him. You said, wow, this isn't good. You know, you judge a person. If you can't judge a person directly, they have a hidden agenda, then judge them by their friends. Judge them by their friends. Who is around them? Who are the helpers they have? Who are the people that they feel comfortable with? You see, this is very important. So you might have somebody who looks brilliant and a great orator and smiles a lot, dresses in nice suits, and everybody thinks they're wonderful. But look at their friends. Look at their confidants. Look at that. That's how you find out what their agenda really is. Who are their mentors, etc. So we go back in history and start digging into Hitler. Say, how do we miss this? How do we miss this? You know, how come we didn't vet this guy better? And you know, then you start saying, wow, there's some red flags here. A lot of red flags. But the world missed it. The world missed it. Okay, it missed it. And the world's maybe missing it again. Missing it again in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways. So it's a global, there's all sorts of problems in the world. There's global problems, and they're hidden because politicians are very good at dissembling and making it seem that no, everything, you know, everything's great. We're going in a great direction. Everybody relax, everybody enjoy. This is, you know, just keep me in power and everything's wonderful. But they may be driven by extreme ideological positions of thinking that they need to fix some great wrong that has somehow been wrong. And this is the case of Hitler, that they felt that Germany had been terribly wronged in World War I, the Treaty of World War I, and it was all a vast conspiracy to destroy the German nation. So they had extreme resentment, hidden resentment, an extreme agenda to right wrong. So when you have a smiling, happy demagogue who's able to sway people very well, you have to look, do they have a hidden agenda? Do they have some festering anger wound in them? Is it from their childhood? Is it from the way they are brought up? They feel, you know, so you have to look for signs of that. A lot of people in America feel there's a hidden agenda at play, not only in America but around the world, that there's a New World Order agenda at play also, and these things could come to a head very quickly, along with natural catastrophes and just a whole ball of wax. It could happen. It could happen. A condition that we would say drastic could very well happen, and there's quite a few people sounding this alarm. I've felt all along that this is going to happen. And so we need to take refuge. We need to be able to take refuge from drasticness, okay? This feeling of like, this is just drastic. Whether it be martial law or just on and on and on, this is just drastic. What's happening is drastic. Now, some people already feel that it's already drastic, and I certainly feel that way. That the world's already in an extremely drastic condition. But some think, well, I still got food on the table, so it's not drastic. But just like when does a drasticness, for example, for the tsunami, when is the condition considered drastic? When the tsunami hits the beach, or when the earthquake happens that generates the tsunami? This is just a difference of opinion. I say the drasticness is there as soon as the earthquake happens, and actually before the earthquake happens, because the pressure is building up along a fault, and you can measure. There's various ways to determinations can be made, saying, you know what, this fault is ready to go. There's like a whole bunch of mini quakes. You can say, hey, you know what, I think we have a drastic situation here. And then the earthquake, certainly when the earthquake happens, you have a drastic situation if it's strong enough to generate a huge tsunami. But a lot of people will say, no, it's only drastic when the tsunami hits the beach. Okay, so this is the difference between me and the mindset I'm talking about in much of the world, is they're not willing to work hard enough. They're too indolent. They're lazy, and they say, no, I just want to keep sitting on this beach and soaking up the sun, and I'm not going to worry about anything until actually the tsunami hits the beach. Okay, so of course then it's too late for most, see? So for me, I said, I'm willing to accept that it's drastic as soon as the earthquake happens, and even before that. I'm willing then to get off the beach and start working like crazy to try to help people, knowing that a lot of people are going to be very indolent and lazy, So I'm not sitting on the beach. Those days are long over, sitting on the beach. I mean, this has been a nonstop effort here. There's something drastic coming. The signs, the alarms are going off all over the place. All the parameters, the alarms are just intense alarm saying this indicates a drastic ideological weather system, so to speak, at play. Now, the question is what to do about it. All right, so this is what we're focusing on. We're not going to obsess about exactly what is going to happen. We know there's a lot of conspiracy people out who obsess too much about what's going to happen and don't spend any time thinking about how do we have peace of mind? Where can we achieve peace of mind? Where do we truly take refuge? Truly take refuge. So we emphasize taking refuge spiritually. It is possible. We have examples of those in this world who had a peaceful mind, extremely peaceful mind, no matter what happened. Nothing bothered it. And this is ultimately what we need to get to. At the very least, we need to associate with such a situation. Or at least be aware it is possible. At least be aware it's possible. And have that as our goal. At least have that as a goal. So we certainly have that as a goal here. I certainly have that as a goal. The best example I know of someone like that. They've been great examples in the world throughout history. And what we don't need to make an idol out of someone who's done this. What we need to realize is that it's possible. It's possible. So I've been digging into finding out, how is this possible? How is this possible? And I've gotten answers. I've gotten answers. It's a lifelong effort. How is this possible? Knowing I had this limited time to get it done, because I know that in 2:15, I was told 2:15 is when, everything's going to hit the fan, really. So here we are in 2:15, halfway through. And, we need answers, and I've got answers, fortunately. So we can take a little full stop on the wow. Wow, he has answers, yes. That's great. That's very good news. Now, not satisfied. We still need a little more than that. but we're in the ballpark in terms of answers. Yesterday I was able to nail down, the last 3 days I've just been nailing down everything that needs to be nailed down, and recognizing that this whole universe is just a completely unnecessary exercise in trying to atone for guilt, a non-existent guilt that we just made up, instead of accepting the feeling of impossibility in terms of when we tried to change the will of God, the feeling arose that it's impossible. And our arrogance, wanting to explore this idea, said, no, that's just guilt. That we did it, but we feel guilty about it. And we have to overcome this guilt, and then we'll be happy. Then we'll truly know how it feels to change the will of God. We can never know how it feels to change the will of God because it's impossible. But instead of accepting this as an impossibility, we interpreted this feeling of this is impossible as guilt, and saying, yeah, we did it, but we feel guilty about it. And so once we free ourselves from this guilt, then we'll know how it feels to change the will of God and be greater than God. But this trying to get rid of a non-existent guilt goes nowhere. It's like this whole universe is completely useless. There's no use for it, actually. Nothing's ever happened. It's totally not needed. And the way we've been trying to get free of this guilt is called death. So this universe is a dream of death and impermanence, called impermanence, which is, you know, death. Dream of impermanence is how we have been trying to get rid of this guilt, which doesn't exist. It's a non-existent guilt. See, you can't have a real guilt when nothing happened. We didn't change the will of God, so how can we feel guilty about changing the will of God? It's impossible. It's ridiculous. It's a total failure. We completely failed to change the will of God. Now, here's the question I asked myself this morning to further this along. I said, hey, wait a minute. Is failure a condition? Is it a condition? What is the condition? We failed to change the will of God. Is that failure to change the will of God, is this a condition? We have assumed it's a condition. But it's like here's this bottle, you know, and I hit the bottle. I'm trying to break it. Boom. Yeah. Boom. 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 Gee, I failed to break the bottle. Okay, what is the failure? What condition is the failure? Okay, what condition is this? Well, I mean, the bottle is just the same as always. Nothing's happened. So our problem is we think that failure gives rise to a condition of failure. This is the additional mistake we have on our mind, that failure is a condition. There's no condition other than exactly what was before. Nothing's happened. How is nothing happening a condition other than nothing's happening? I mean, nothing's happened to something. Nothing happened to this bottle. So how does that give rise to some condition that is somehow different than what was previously there? See, this is the trouble our minds are having. And we struggle with this, and we stumble. So, wait a minute. It's like we're trying to change reality. We failed. How does that give rise to some condition? It doesn't. Reality is still exactly the same as it's always been, without the slightest change whatsoever. There is no condition of failure. Failure doesn't give rise to a condition. Like zero times something doesn't give rise to a quantity. Zero times, 100 is zero. It doesn't give rise to a quantity, no matter what you multiply it by. So failure to change reality doesn't give rise to some condition at all. But we insist that somehow failure, there's a condition associated with that. And what we're doing is calling it guilt, and then trying to atone and get rid of this guilt. So we're so used to believing that failure is a condition. Okay. We're so used to it that we're terrified. I mean, if we give up that failure is a condition, the whole universe will disappear, really. We realize instantly we have zero need for it, and we'll let go of it. So we're afraid. We have a continuity fear. We have a continuity fear. As I've always said, the continuity fear is the only problem that we have, actually. That's it. Okay, now. So we have this belief that failure gives rise to a condition of failure. That zero gives rise to some quantity of zero, which it doesn't, of course, but we desire that it does so, even though it doesn't. We still have this desire, like, okay, and we're afraid to drop this desire right off, you know, directly. We're afraid to directly drop it. So what do we do? As I've always said, intermediate step. This is what Jesus teaches, intermediate step. Now, I asked the Holy Spirit, how do we get this intermediate step? I was in my mind, I was saying, wow, this is, you know, what condition can failure have? And the Holy Spirit gave me the answer, and it was like awesome. It says the condition-free condition. The Holy Spirit says, abide in the condition-free condition. Now, this, I said, yes, I get it. And I liken this to, there's a different ways of liken it to it. For example, I liken it to like this vast ocean. Imagine a vast ocean in all directions. And on this vast ocean, there is not even the slightest ripple. It is completely still. There's no conditions arising. So there's this condition, the ocean, that is free of conditions. Now, I might say, well, the ocean itself is conditioned, but we can't give it really any attributes. We say it's just this massive stillness, and there's no conditions arising from that. It's the condition-free condition. Okay, here's another example. Let's imagine this vast expanse that's utter perfect darkness, absolute perfect darkness, and there's not the tiniest trace of light in this darkness whatsoever. There's no conditions arising, no appearances arising, no, nothing arising. It's perfectly still, perfectly quiet, nothing arising. This would be a condition-free condition. The condition-free condition. Now, it is symbolic, of course. It's still perception. But it is the intermediate step. But once we experience the condition-free condition, then it's easy from there to realize that failure has no conditions at all, and even set down the vast ocean, the vast darkness, the beautiful inky darkness where nothing is happening, no conditions are arising. You can't do anything. It's like a pigment of paint. Imagine an ocean of black paint that is. It contains all pigments, right? And no matter what pigment you try to pour into that ocean, it remains absolutely black. It contains all pigments in it. So whatever rain hits that black pigment, whatever paint is just pouring in, nothing is happening to it. Its character doesn't change in the slightest bit. So from the standpoint of pigments, you know, the black contains all pigments, so to speak. You mix all pigments together, you end up with black. So imagine you're in this great ocean of black pigment, of black paint, and you're just sitting quietly there, and nothing is disturbing. Nothing is changing it whatsoever. It's the condition-free condition. It is the condition-free condition. Abiding in this condition-free condition prevents drasticness from striking your mind, you see. No matter what happens, nothing changes in this perfectly black pigment. Stays the same. So we can use this metaphor of this vast, endless black ocean of black pigment, black paint. And we just abide in this ocean. It covers us. We're sitting in the middle of this ocean, beneath the surface in it. And so all the stuff that's being poured into the ocean, whatever it is, it doesn't change the pigment at all. It just mixes, the black absorbs it. The black is so perfectly black. It absorbs all pigments, and they just become black. No conditions are arising. the ocean remains the same. This is the conditioned free condition. So when I heard this, when I this idea popped into my mind, I said, yes, this has got to be it. This is what I've been looking for. This is the remedy. Now, is there anybody, again, who exemplifies this? Raman Maharshi exemplifies it. He was in this conditioned-free condition. He was abiding in it. Nothing that happened caused any wavering at all in this condition. Didn't waver at all. Births, deaths, accidents, catastrophes, tears, anger, hysteria, arguments, intellect, you know, emotions, this or that, and it had no effect on it. He was reading this perfect peace of mind, perfect stability of mind, perfect stability of mind. He was abiding in what he called the self, which I call the conditioned-free condition. Now, the self is not the ultimate, but beyond the self, there's nothing that we can say about it at all. And it's not a goal of ours. It cannot be seen as a goal at all. But abiding in the self can be seen as a goal. Abiding in the condition-free condition, absolutely we can see that as a goal and reach it. And we can do this. We can do this. Now, there are those who might say, well, I don't think I'd be able to get there realistically. Say, I'm not quite, you know. Well, okay. That's fair enough. And there are those who say, wow, that's just way too difficult. Fair enough. So it's all different degrees of readiness for that. But if anyone is in that condition, free condition, this is a powerful entrainment to it, very powerful. And it gives people tremendous hope, actually. And they say, you know, I don't need to succumb to the drastic, this feeling of drasticness. There's this, I can abide in the condition-free condition if I just continue on with my, you know, clarification and discipline. And it takes the edge off of the drasticness, you know, it really does. And so whatever efforts one can make, it's beneficial to everyone. It's beneficial to everyone. Just like Rana Maharshi, it's been beneficial to everyone, really. And even though he's been gone since 1950, I believe it's 1950, the influence is still there. The beneficialness is still there. The example he set is still here for us, you know. And we don't have to follow, you know, put it into Hindu terms or Advaita terms, or I don't put it into Advaita terms or Hindu terms, or I see it in terms of a Course in Miracle terms, or a Journey Beyond Words terms, and even that I have my own sort of way of looking at it, Holy Spirit terminology. It doesn't matter at all. What we're after is the goal is the condition-free condition, the condition-free condition. Now, think about, where is it? Well, it must be right here, right? Because there's no conditions. And when? It must be right now, because there's no conditions to it. There's no conditions to it whatsoever. It's free of all conditions. So how could it be at a distance? That's a condition. How could it be having to wait for it? That's a condition. The condition-free condition must be right here, right now. This is the only sane way to look at it. It must be right here, right now. Kingdom of Heaven is within, meaning there's no conditions to reach it. It must be right here, right now. The conditioned free condition. Right here, right now. And truly, this is the only judgment that God puts upon this dream. You call it the glorification of perfection, the conditioned free condition. The final judgment, of course, is that none of this is needed. And God's Son is perfect, just as it always has been. There's no guilt to atone for at all. I didn't set this video. I don't think I can set it while it's going. Oh well, it'll just go as long as it goes. That's okay. That's okay. We're just getting to the meat of this now and really hearing what it's saying. Can I adjust it? No. Okay, well, it'll just go as long as it goes. The condition-free condition. So we have a terminology now, the condition-free condition. Ramana said, abide in the self. I never quite understood what he's talking about. I do now. So it's the condition-free condition. Because we have believed that failure to change the will of God is a condition. And we're not willing to give that up yet. Because it's too direct for us. It'll be too frighteningly direct. So we'll say, yeah, it's a condition. It's the condition-free condition. And we'll symbolize that. It's symbolized perceptually. In it, like we're abiding in this vast, cool darkness where no matter what light of what we think are conditions try to hit it, it doesn't change it at all. You know, it's just like pouring pigment into an ocean of black pigment. It doesn't change it at all. So no matter what the universe does, it doesn't affect it in the slightest bit. So we're abiding in this condition-free condition. This nullifies the feeling of drasticness. Okay, no matter what happens, the feeling of drasticness will not arise. So we can take comfort in that. You're starting to see how important the spiritual path is, how important it is to live your life focusing on saints, sages, and those enlightened beings. They're super important, super, super important. That's been my only focus in life, knowing that it's essential, especially when drasticness occurs in this world, which it often does. I mean, World War II was quite drastic. We are told that this situation coming up next will be way more drastic. Has the potential to be, for sure. There's no doubt about it. With cyber warfare and the way things are all set up electronically now, the capacity for extreme mischief is just off the charts. And there's a lot of stuff that's off the charts. So we're starting to say, hey, you know what? Maybe I should have paid more attention. Maybe I should have given more attention to the great sages and saints and the gurus and enlightened ones. And you know, maybe they had something that's helpful, beneficial. Maybe we shouldn't have gone so secular. Maybe we shouldn't have gone so materialistic. Maybe we dropped the ball. Maybe we took our eye off the prize. It says, wow, maybe I need to turn around and start paying attention, more attention. Maybe I should have more insight into this, more acceptance, more attention, more focus, more effort, more patience, more perseverance, all of this. I think a lot of people are going into turtle mode, like in the shell, saying, wait a minute, wow, drasticness is coming. I just don't know what I'm going to do. I'm just going to like withdraw and sleep all day or go into frantic mode. Let's just party, party, party. Party it away. Reaction formation. It's a reaction formation. It's like the Titanic. They knew something bad was going to happen. There's an intuition of it. And most of the people are like just partying like crazy. Yeah? A few people are out there saying, wow, I see some icebergs floating by. This something isn't right. This feel kind of eerie here. Let's check the lifeboats out. Others with the reaction formation were like just partying, drinking, gambling, like dancing like mad. As in the days of Noah, so shall it be in those days. As in the days of Lot, so shall it be in those days. Luke 17, starting in Luke 17:25. Jesus likens what's going to happen in the end times, like in the days of Noah before the flood, and the days of Lot in Sodom and Gomorrah before they were, destroyed by fire and brimstone. Those days where people were severely engaged in reaction formation, as I believe we are now. I believe this world is engaging in massive reaction formation. The closer we get to drasticness, the more people are engaging in reaction formation, and this is a very dangerous situation. You don't want to get pulled into that. Say, let's party, let's have more and more parades, more and more drugs, more and more sex, more and more drugs, more and more rock and roll. Let's just act like, wow, this is great what's happening. And if we just pretend like it's we're celebrating what's coming, you know, it won't happen. That's reaction formation. That's sticking your head in the ground, ostrich style. So I think that there's a big divide in the world between those who are earnestly and genuinely trying to find peace of mind and those who are saying, hey, reaction formation is the answer, you have, which is insanity. Now, celebrating, finding the right answer, that's not a reaction formation at all. But when you don't know how to have peace of mind and you're just celebrating for the purpose of thinking that magically will prevent drasticness from happening, that's a reaction formation. That's insanity. So I feel a lot of the world has gone the way of insanity in looking at the internet and looking at people's reactions, politicians, news people, posters. I'm trying to track a wide sampling of people. You know, a lot of people have gone into reaction formation right now already. So a tremendous number of them. We're certainly not going into reaction formation. That doesn't mean that we won't celebrate and be happy. But we'll celebrate and be happy when we have the answer, you know. And getting to this answer, recognizing this fundamental mistake that we've made, I mean, to believe that failure to change God's will isn't failure, it's actually success. We succeeded, but just feel guilty about it. To make this dualistic, arrogant imagination, you know, failure is not dualistic, it's singular. We failed, that's it. Reality is still reality. It's singular. But what we did is we said, no, we didn't fail. We succeeded, but we have guilt. So those are two things, two lies. We succeeded, that's the lie, but the problem is guilt over succeeding. That is the essence of duality right there. That's how duality started. So to see that is a huge, monumental, historic success, and I imagine my teachers are dancing on the ceiling. They should be. If I was a teacher and one of my students got to this point, you know, I would be absolutely ecstatic. It's so difficult to get to see this. It is so difficult, and they've put so much effort in. The teachers put so much effort in this world to help us, and as a student of these teachers, I've put so much effort in, and they've put so much effort in helping me to get to this recognition. It is such a tremendous success. You can't even measure it. It's such a great thing. So I imagined, you know, that my teachers are just like wanting to throw the biggest party ever. You know, they're just like, they're absolutely ecstatic about this. And then to go on and recognize that, you know, the think that failure, it has a condition attached, is another massive recognition. And then to accept that the conditions recondition is the remedy is another massive breakthrough, historically great breakthrough. So yeah, I just feel like my teachers, you know, they may throw the biggest party ever. I'll be the guest of honor there. But teachers, what is their job? I mean, what is Jesus' job? It's to bring us to this realization and free us from insanity. That's all he focuses on. That is it. So he's a complete teacher. These teachers are absolutely committed to teaching. And so what does a teacher want? They want their students to be successful. That is it. Nothing else. They're single-minded about that. Holy Spirit, too. Single-minded about we want success, our students to be successful. So when some student is actually successful, you know, this just must send them over the moon. You know, I mean, this is the greatest thing ever for them. That is just, you know, has to resonate. And it has to. This is my viewpoint. Because if I was a teacher and I was in their shoes looking at this, I would just be jubilant, you know, and it wouldn't stop. It wouldn't stop. It wouldn't like say, oh, that's nice, yeah, that's great, I'm a little happy for you. No, the jubilation just would not stop. This is super important. It proves that this can get through even in these drastic times. Okay, it proves it. It's just such a tremendous accomplishment and breakthrough for my teachers, really. You know, they're the ones who provided the impetus and the motivation and the examples and the constant help. You know, so it's an enormous success for my teachers. And for everyone that's helped out and tried to help me, you know, along the way, it's an enormous success for them. And so I'm feeling like, you know, I don't know what's going to happen, but I just feel, you know, I would like throw a massive party. I would just, you know, but maybe more pragmatic than that and say, well, no, you know, let's still stay pragmatic. But still, you know, at some point, you got to get a pat on the back. You got to celebrate. I mean, accomplish something that is truly magnificent, you know, to just ignore it and not celebrate it doesn't seem to be kosher at all, in my opinion. But they may have their own ideas. I have to accept whatever it is. But I feel it's important. We always celebrate, you know, milestones, right? And it's important to acknowledge, like, this is a huge milestone. Huge milestone. And to acknowledge and to celebrate a milestone, I feel it's pretty darn important. But so I don't know what they're gonna do. But this is my dreams have just been lousy. You know, there's nothing there really. I had one night before last that was pretty awesome, and I'll tell you what that is. I found myself in this like a marketplace, kind of real crowded, hustling, bustling marketplace, and there's a whole bunch of people like wanting to go toward the exit, went through sort of this one sort of corridor, and then and going toward the door that goes out of the market. Okay, so I was jostling. There's a lot of jostling, and it's really crowded, and I found myself going through this corridor, kind of towards the exit, and I found someone pressed up against me. It's like, wow, it's so crowded here. We're pressing up against one another. So I kind of tried to adjust my body so I weren't pressing up against them, you know, just out of politeness, of course. And yeah, but they, you know, the way the crowd kept moving, it seemed like they kept pressing up against me. I said, wow, they must be getting pushed from somebody. What's happening? What's going on? And it continued the whole way through this corridor. And finally, we popped out of this corridor, you know, and then there was this door that opened up. We could get out of the marketplace. And I said, wow, that was really weird. You know, they're pressed against me the whole time. You know, really pressed up against me. And it's like, I try not to pay any attention, because usually you don't try to pay attention. But finally we got free and they were not pressed up against me after that. And so I looked to see who it was. And it was this woman, a young woman. And this young woman was like, the way she presented herself was like the most beautiful woman you could hardly imagine. You know, fresh and young and blonde hair, beautiful blonde hair done just beautifully and tastefully in the clothing. Everything's just like the image of a perfect woman, okay? And it's just like, whoa, this is extraordinary. You know, what in the world? And then she looked at me, you know, as we finally separated like that from the crowd, pressure of the crowd. And she looked at me like, wow. Oh my gosh. It's like she saw me. Oh my gosh, you know, this is destiny, you know. Destiny pushed us together. This was the overriding meta message that was presented to me right then. Was that destiny, this crowd and this marketplace, somehow destiny had pushed us together like that and kept us together all that time. And this was a message to us that we needed to be together, period. This is the meta message that struck, you know, like lightning. And she acted like she was completely aware of it too. And she's looking, are you aware of it? Are you feeling what I'm feeling? This is the classic thing. Hey, are you feeling what I'm feeling? Destiny, there's destiny at work here, you know. And What I did, I was aware of all this. Somehow, I simply didn't say anything, and I just walked out the exit of that market and went to my car. Okay, I didn't say anything because I had this inner spiritual premonition somehow. Somehow I didn't react. I did not take the bait. I mean, this, and so then I saw her walk past me very quickly and jump into this car. And I looked at the car. It was this powerful sports car. I looked at the car and looked at the color. And it was this dull gray, very dull gray car. And then I realized, when I saw that, I realized, wow, that was a setup. That was a setup. Okay, it was a setup. I also noted in her clothing, she had, you know, very tasteful clothing on. It was, everything was done like perfectly. But she had this silver lining in all her clothes and the edging of it. Everything was lined with a silver thread, a silver cord, so to speak, everywhere. That set her off in this, you know, very subtle ornamentation way, but it was very effective, extremely effective. And so what she was doing was saying, hey, I can present you with a silver lining. No matter what happens, I can present you with a silver lining. Okay. In other words, you know, like, if you're with me, if we're together, you will be able to give a silver lining to the world. Okay. I didn't take the bait. I did not take the bait. And I woke up and I realized this was a tremendous breakthrough. And, you know, she and her driver got out of there in a big hurry. And they failed. They failed. It was absolutely a setup. Now, yesterday, after this dream, I had this experience that was quite extraordinary. And this is maybe too much for anyone to believe, but I'm saying it's true. Absolutely. This has been part of a setup. I was downloading these pictures of Ananda Maima, the great guru, truly a great guru. I've been doing this for about 18 years. As a matter of fact, I have the greatest collection of pictures of Ananda Maima of anyone in the world. I have virtually every picture that exists. Thousands. And I was led into doing this, a project. I call the Ananda Maima Picture Archive Project. I've been working on this for 18 years. And I've been pressured to do this. And yet, I don't really like doing it. It did not bring me the spiritual benefit that I thought it would. It did not. And as I was downloading, I found some more pictures that I'd never seen before. Quite a few, actually. It was amazing. I suddenly realized something. And I said, oh my gosh. Oh my God. I'm under intense pressure to put all of these pictures online in a collection, okay, thousands of them, along with all the artwork I've done with her picture, which is, I have hundreds and hundreds, maybe even a thousand of those pictures of extraordinarily graphic arts in making it look, you know, very interesting and beautiful and attractive and exceptional and extraordinary, and just, it's just amazing, all the artwork I've done. Mind-blowing, really. I'm under intense pressure to put that out on the web in a collection. Under intense pressure. Spirit, I feel it, you know, but I'm resisting it. I've been resisting it. I've also under intense pressure to produce these videos about her life with all these extraordinary graphics. And I've been under this tense pressure for 18 years. And yet it hasn't, no good has come of it to me. No good has come of it at all. Which is really weird. Because she absolutely is one of the greatest gurus that's ever been here in this world. And yet, something's wrong. You know, it's like, something doesn't add up. But I couldn't figure out what it is. I've known that there's something that isn't quite right here. But I couldn't, and then suddenly it clicked into my mind what it is. Because I'm under this intense pressure right now to do this massive dump on like Flickr or Facebook or whatever of all these pictures and all these videos and everything I've done to make this huge collection for the whole world to have access to. And there's this pressure, it's very important to do this. What I suddenly realized, and it, It's a shocker, but I accepted it. It's true that this whole plan of to produce all these graphics, these images of Anandamayi was actually a setup, okay? And the purpose of it, ultimately the purpose, that the aim of this was for me to dump all this stuff on the internet, make it available, and turn everyone's attention to this, especially high spiritual aspirants who would be interested in it, solely for the purpose to distract their attention away from Jesus, because Jesus is back in this world right now and is working through his apostles right now. And all of this was known ahead of time, that Jesus was coming back, and there are those who wanted to defeat his purpose here, and they felt they could defeat it by turning people's attention away from Jesus onto something that's super spiritually attractive. Okay, Anandamayi Ma is the most spiritually attractive being I've ever seen. But the fact is, her work that she did is done. She's gone off the scene. It's now Jesus' time to take the stage, you see. So they were trying to upstage Jesus. And all of this work for 17 years that I've done was only for that purpose, actually. And I said, I'm not going to do it, you know. So all that time is wasted. All that effort is wasted, you know. But it was all designed to upstage Jesus. I said, I'm not going to upstage Jesus. No way. I don't care. For anyone's sake, not even for Anandamayi Ma's sake, am I going to upstage Jesus. And if she doesn't like it, too bad. I'm sure she's happy I'm not doing this. But, you know, hey, I don't care. Well, you know, I'm not going to upstage Jesus. Nobody should upstage Jesus, plain and simple. No one. Jesus deserves the spotlight now. Absolutely he does. Because he made good on his promise to come back. He has already come back, and he made good on that promise, and he has brought the greatest teaching ever, okay, that has been more helpful than anything I've ever come across in this world, to clarify the overall context of the whole situation. Jesus deserves the spotlight, so I am not going to do this dump. I'm not going to do it. It's not going to happen. Very clever. And that lady in the dream was part of this scam. And if I would have responded in the dream to her, like, this is destiny, that together we're going to provide this great silver lining to the world, there's no doubt in my mind that I would have done this Anandamayi Ma dump, and that would have been our focus, and we would have turned people's attention and say, hey, everybody, look at these images, and this is going to be the silver lining that will help you avoid this drasticness. And it would have failed. It wouldn't have worked. Images are not sufficient. I don't care if they're the images of the greatest teacher that's ever lived. They're not sufficient. It's an idol. You're still involved in idolatry. Okay? So, we pay attention to who's actually here right now. This is what we... That's what we need to pay attention to. Who's on the stage right now? The living presence right now. Okay? It's Jesus. So, this is where I'm directing people's attention to. So it was a, you know, I mean, it's a rough, not too rough, because it solves an extreme mystery. It solves an extreme mystery. I was definitely misled. I did make lemonade out of a lemon, so to speak. It's been very instructive. I find that the female type of guru is very helpful in an intermediate stage. First stage was Jesus, and I found out what it's all about, and then I got cold feet. I said, wow, you're really headed towards complete renunciation of the universe. I said, I don't know if I can handle that. And I said, wow, it's too much. What can I do? And then Anandamayi Ma was this female enlightened being. So it made you feel like, at least I can relate. I want to still feel in relation to something. So I said, I'll be in relation to her, that kind of thing. So I said, I don't need to reject the universe. I can still, it enabled me this intermediate stage where I felt I could still relate. It wasn't a complete renunciate. I wasn't ready for it. So I said, let me make her my companion. So she was my companion for quite some time, so to speak, in spirit. And she doesn't really teach the level of renunciation that Jesus is teaching, not exactly. Not exactly. So there's some wiggle room there. But then once I worked through that, I realized, hey, no, you know what? We'll work through all the goddess stuff and say, I don't need the goddess. The goddess is terrible, actually. She helps you do that. But then I said, hey, you know what? I think I am ready for renunciation. So at that point, I set her down and I went back to Jesus. So the way I see it, it's a 1-2-3 situation. First, you realize that renunciation is necessary. Truly, it is. Then you go through a phase, say, I'm not quite ready for it. So let me associate with someone who's divine, the divinity, but doesn't demand complete renunciation of me. That I can still feel like, oh, you know, she's my friend. I can be hang out with her and we can have flowers and you know, we don't need to quite renunciate the universe. See? And then the third phase is you go back and say, yes, I can renounce the universe. Yes, I can. Yes, I can do that. Ramana Maharshi's example of the third phase teacher. Okay, it was too much for me. I couldn't go with that third, that final stage like Ramana Maharshi of true enunciation like that. So the intermediate is the goddess. There is a goddess phase that we can go through, where we say, "Oh, I'm with the most wonderful person. You know, I'm this is just wonderful being, and look at all the lights and the singing, and the flowers and the pomp and circumstance, and yet it's also divine and there's also an austerity there and a seriousness and everything. So it acts as this bridge, from realization that renunciation is needed, a bridge to actual renunciation. So I understand it in that context. So I made lemonade out of the lemon, but I was aware all the while that the arrogance, the voice of arrogance, the ego, saw a different purpose, a different way to use Ananda Maima, and that is to block Jesus, to turn people's attention away from Jesus when he returned. And it insisted, arrogance insisted that I work on that. And I was unable to, you know, to not work on it. But it was a disaster for me, terrible. So it's quite amazing. This is all entirely true, and I'm not going to post the photos just to try to prove it true, because that would be, you know, spiting myself. You know, that would be insane. You know, but I most certainly do have, you know, this just unbelievable collection. And people say, "Oh, you got to give it out to the world. Oh, it's so important." No, I don't. It would be a disaster to do that. This is not the purpose of the Holy Spirit at all. It's a cop-out. It's an attempt to avoid the renunciation we really need. It's an attempt to think we can be happy looking at a photograph, okay? That's not going to cut it right now. It's not going to cut it. So I had this dream where I refused this so-called, you know, this is destiny, and this goddess. She was absolutely a goddess looking. I mean, you someone who was dressed and presented as a perfect goddess. But the silver lining, I realized she was only there to provide a silver lining. And a silver lining is not the same as abiding in the condition-free condition. And the drasticness that is coming requires abiding in the condition-free condition. That's not a silver lining. That is absolute abidance in peace of mind and calm. Okay. So, you know, these are astonishing insights. And another thing that I noticed, as I tried to download these photos and get to them, my computer always slowed down, and a lot of times it crashed. It was the most frustrating thing. I said, here's a picture. How come I can't suddenly the web page will freeze up and I have to reload it or restart the computer? I mean, it just became extraordinarily difficult to just download these pictures. I said, well, this is bizarre. Absolutely bizarre. And then I realized that this is showing me you're trying to slow things down. Ananda Maima was great. She speeded things up. But Jesus has come to really speed it up even more to the ultimate extent. Okay. And this is not trying to say one is greater than the other. It's Ananda Maima played a role here. She played a role. Okay. But she's not the role. She transcends the role. But she did play a role. And from our pragmatic standpoint where we're at, roles are important. Roles are very important. Okay. So we have to understand that she did play this role. It was very helpful. But now it's time for Jesus to play his role. Okay, so we got to let Jesus play his role. We have to give him the opportunity to play his role. Okay, and again, We're not comparing. I believe both of them are perfectly enlightened, without any question. I believe that. And yet, from a pragmatic standpoint, there are roles to be played. And when someone appears as a female, in the female role here in this world, we automatically attach some, there's some reaction of the flesh to that. There absolutely is. We react as the mother, okay? We cannot help to say, oh, the mother, well, she feeds us, she gives us food, she gives us good things, she helps us, but it's related to our body. We cannot help but have some feeling of body relatedness to a female figure who arises in this world. We cannot help it. So, Anandamayamop did play this role, which is a bridge type of role, where we have some, we're not renouncing the flesh altogether. They're not saying, hey, I realize it's all completely unnecessary, no need for it whatsoever, there's never been any need for it, we're not there yet, but we still want to keep the momentum on the spiritual path. So we identify with a female enlightened being, and so that still keeps a feeling of the flesh there. It did still kept the feeling of the flesh, was still there, but it helped bridge me, work through that, where I realized, wow, even the most beautiful goddess, that's still not the answer. No appearance of flesh is the answer whatsoever. And now I'm ready for Jesus, you know, Jesus to play his role here, which is to take refuge in the condition-free condition. Take refuge in the condition-free condition, where you realize there's zero necessity to this universe, zero necessity to it. The Son of God can never experience necessity. It's impossible. Totally impossible. There's zero guilt. Zero guilt, and failure is not a condition, you see. So I'm ready for that. Okay, so Anandamayamop played her role. Now it's time for Jesus to play his role. This is very simple. But what a diabolical scheme that was. And I'm aware, I have a feeling about who was behind it. I call it the Zeta Reticulans, the Greys, the Grey extraterrestrials. Those are the little, let's use an expletive there, who are very adept at this sort of thing. And this goddess-like figure jumped into a Grey car, the very color of their skin. Okay, it was the exact color of the Zeta Reticulans' skin. Those little extraterrestrials with the big slanted almond-like eyes, you know. They're nasty business, to say the least. They're special ops. And they specialize in this very sort of clever... They love this extremely subtle trickery like this that they instituted upon me. And I was aware that there was... Someone was up to no good with this whole situation. They were trying to twist it and turn it in the wrong direction. I was certainly aware, but I couldn't figure out, you know, how could it be wrong? How could the spreading the pictures of Anandamayamop, how could that be wrong? You know, it seems like it has to be right, but it turns out it wasn't. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? So these special ops of the Zeta Reticulans are just, you know, they're just as nasty can get. They play the most treacherous hardball possible. This was extreme treachery. All set up to make me think like I'm doing the greatest good for the world. Hey, what's wrong? Why don't share the spotlight? You see, what's the matter, you sexist? You don't want to share the spotlight? And again, we're talking, remember, from the standpoint of helping us out, it's pragmatism. And these great gurus know that. She played the role at the time that she needed to play it, and then she exited the stage at the time she needed to exit it. She didn't need to exit the stage. Actually, she could have been immortal and stayed here forever. She chose to exit the stage because that's what God wanted. Okay, the plan of God said, okay, it's exit the stage now. She gave no resistance to it whatsoever, no spiritual ego at all. Now it's time for Jesus to enter the stage. Okay. Our full attention needs to be on Jesus, whereas these Zeta Reticulans have tried to institute this idealistic ideology in the world of fairness, and we got to share the spotlight. All this, remember, the situation we're in is an extraordinarily pragmatic one, okay, and it's not an ideological one. It is not an ideal one. We have to make the right moves in the right time because we're in this extraordinarily mental trap with this extraordinary continuity fear. And it's very difficult to make the grade here. And you've got to know when to zig and when to zag and when to go this way and that way. And this is orchestrated. It's orchestrated. And you cannot just stand up there and spout idealism, okay? Spouting idealism is actually trying to throw a monkey wrench into the whole thing. And so the Zeta Reticulans, who are largely responsible for orchestrating the inner psychic reactions to what's going on, they're very clever little expletives. And they are pushing this ideological, demagogic ideology of fairness, you know. Fairness, fairness, fairness. The whole thing is sharing the spotlight. This is what their whole, one of their most important pushes is sharing the spotlight. And I've been speaking about this over and over, about how I've noticed that they have their operatives, and they're always female now, hosting these shows that have always been male. Why? Because it's been men who built the situation, who did all the work, who have taken all the risks, who have done all the competition, who have done all the massive risk and effort to come up a winner, like NASCAR, for instance, or something. Okay. There's one female racer now, Danica Patrick, but NASCAR is a man thing. Okay. So I saw that the finish of this NASCAR. I don't watch races anymore. I used to watch some, but here's this show, you know, after the race or something. And it cuts to the show. And who is in the spotlight? After this huge build-up and this race, and everyone's in like this maximum mode now to hail the champion. Okay, this is how athletics go. We get in this mood of all hail the champion. And the spotlight is supposed to be on the champion. As we cut to this, whether it's baseball, football, any sport, when you cut to this all-important moment where you want your full attention and emotion and praise is going to be on the champion, because, you know, from a man's standpoint, we understand the competition and the toughness and the risk and the difficulty, and these people have spent their whole life dedicated to this, to be a champion, and we value this, and we understand just how difficult it is to be a champion. So we're there to give them praise. Okay, what happens when the camera cuts on that moment, we're ready to get praise? It always now cuts on to this glamorous bimbo, okay? This glamorous skirt. Hi, smiling, all dolled up and glamorized out, you know, look real sexy and glamorous. And blah, 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 blah. She's totally in control. And all of that praise and attention that you have, you know, ends up going on to her. You can't stop. It's like, wow. And then here's the champion, and she's asking questions. How do you think about it? Okay. Da, da, da. She's completely in control of the situation. Every last single one now. Even NASCAR. Is like, I was just stunned. Basketball, same thing. Who's presenting the trophy now in like the World Series? Who presents the trophy? It's a woman. It's a woman presents the trophy. She is hogging the spotlight. What accomplishments have these bimbos done that they have the right to share the spotlight with this champions, people who have absolutely blood, sweat, and tears given it their all in their life to attain the mountaintop? What right do these media relation bimbos have to share the spotlight with them, to hog the spotlight? Actually, they actually hog the spotlight. This is a absolutely psychop to the ultimate extent, and the Zeta Reticulans are behind this. This is exactly what they do. They have their slimy paws over all of this, and ultimately their goal was to try to get to hog the spotlight with Jesus. Okay, they know that Jesus is coming back. They're terrified of this. They're absolutely terrified of Jesus. They've been trying to block him for such a long time. They hate the fact that he's back. He's actually back. They hate it. They are trying to block the message. They're trying to hog the spotlight with Jesus. They're trying to put the attention onto their operatives, which is glamour, body, guilt, the whole theme of arrogance. So when you turn your attention to Jesus, they want a woman to be there saying, hey, Jesus, interviewing Jesus. Hey, Jesus, so, you know, the blonde hair is there, you know, the busty blonde, she's all made up and so glamorous, looking such beautiful fashion, you know, and They want the attention on that. So all their willingness to put your full attention on the champion, that willingness is now being used for your attention to go on to this glamorous bimbo. This is what they're doing. This is so vicious. This is so vicious what they've done. Yeah, I've been outraged by this all along, and the outrage is even getting stronger and stronger, because I know what they're up to. This is dastardly psychop, dastardly psychop. And they were trying to use me to shift the attention off of Jesus onto Ananda my Ma, you see. That's exactly what they're trying to use me for. This is vicious, vicious hardball that they're playing, and they're just, you know, again, absolute expletives for this. Absolute expletives. And I hope they absolutely fail, you know, completely fail. It'll be good for them to absolutely fail. This is the level. This is the subtlety of what's going on with these extraterrestrials. Most people don't understand it. This planet is being incorporated by extraterrestrials. And they are very, very nasty critters, to say the least. And they are very sly and subtle and sophisticated leopards. You know, they camouflage themselves. It's the leopard, which I say the flag that was attached with the POTUS's Facebook account. It says "Love Wins," and there's the rainbow flag up there is an exact profile of a leopard. Exact profile of a leopard. It's on Facebook. "Love Wins." Check it out. Exact profile of a leopard, and the leopard is the most vicious and dangerous predator in the whole world, actually. They're able to remain super camouflaged to the last second. They're able to strike with great stealth. Silence, stealth, cunning, camouflage. This perfectly describes the Zeta Reticulans. Okay. Perfectly describes them. And suddenly, vicious strike happens. And they are trying to condition everybody to that if this bimbo is not in control as the host of whatever you're talking about, of the champion is there, then you shouldn't watch it all. It's sexist. This is the vicious meta-message that they have been promoting through what I say the liberal progressives, the fanatical progressives, are working for the Zeta Reticulans. They almost certainly are in this cosmic corporate culture incorporating this planet. This is what's been going on. And this is just the most incredible proof. And no matter, you know, every situation, the Super Bowl, I believe it was a woman who presented the Super Bowl trophy in the NBA championship. The Warriors just won the NBA championship. All hail to that franchise who's been struggling in hell for 40 years. Absolute hell. I've been through the hell for 40 years with them. Finally, they make this stupendous accomplishment for us. Who hogs the spotlight? A woman. A woman. She's given the trophy. She's interviewing the commissioner. She's interviewing Steph Curry. She's interviewing things. The spotlight is on her more than it is on anyone else. Same thing with Aaron Andrews in the Giants win the World Series. She's the one hogging the spotlight. Super Bowl, I believe, is the same thing. Okay, Fox is notorious for putting all these bimbos there. But every channel does it. Everywhere now. Everywhere. And during the game, they have these info babes, you know, giving information constantly during the game. So they're hogging the spot. They're not doing a damn thing. Excuse my French. To play the game at all. It's the players who are out there playing the game. I mean, you can get anybody off the street and dress them up in a skirt and makeup and give them a script to ask a few questions. It doesn't take any talent to do that at all. It doesn't take any talent. Now, there's some that are talented, and I give them their due for that. You know, I'm not biased at all. If someone's talent, they're talented. You know, the one who did the NBA thing was pretty talented. I wasn't really bothered by her too much. She knew her stuff. She was very talented, and she was not all glamorized out, etc. But the principle is the same. They're hogging the spotlight. What you want up there is some old bald-headed man who with an old suit, you know, just, you know. And this is how it used to be, and you didn't pay attention to it at all. You put your full attention on the champions. Okay, and they would just say, okay, how do you feel, so-and-so? And he said, well, you know, this is great. He's just sitting there like, yeah. They weren't supposed to be the story. Okay, they were supposed to be nameless, faceless shadows, and the attention is supposed to be on, you know, the accomplishments, those who did the hard work, period. And everybody, this has been the way it's been. This is the right way. But when you put a bimbo up there, automatically attention goes to the flesh. It goes to her. she hogs the spotlight. They're notorious now. This is the end game that the Zeta Reticulans have been going after, is to jump in onto the stage and hog the spotlight and take attention away from Jesus when he returns. He's already back, folks. And disasters are right around the corner. Drasticness is right around the corner. And what has happened is they've conditioned most of the people on the planet to feel it's only fair if this bimbo is there. You got to have the flesh there too. That's fair. No, it's not fair. They haven't done a damn thing to deserve the spotlight. Excuse my French again. Again, it's a what they're doing doesn't take hardly any talent at all. You know, just have a young, attractive body and have some makeup artists and hair stylists and, you know, wardrobe people dress her up like she looks like a goddess, and then say, hey, Joe, you know, congratulations, Joe. You know, she's primping and styling for the camera. Hey, Joe, congratulations, Joe. What a great job. You're champions, Joe. How do you feel about that, Joe? You know, a four-year-old could do that. You know, here's Joe, who's dedicated his entire life to becoming an expert, absolute expert, and the best of the best in the world, okay? And here's this four-year-old, you know, in a 23-year-old's body, you know, say, hey, Joe, you know, you're champion. How do you feel about that, Joe? And Joe says, well, you know, it's unbelievable. I don't even know how to explain it. Well, Joe, you look like you had, you know, kind of struggled there, Joe, but you finally pulled through, Joe. And, you know, it's really neat watching you guys, and you've been really going through a lot, Joe, blah, 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 blah. So, hey, Joe, you know, what does it feel like right now, Joe? You know, it's like, wow, you know, I'm just, you know, I like to explain, but, you know, and says, well, Joe, that's really great. Now, hey, is your mom and dad here, Joe? And I see, aren't you happy, Joe? You know, this is exactly what they're doing. It's exactly what they're doing. And these bimbos have been trained. I say, I blame Oprah for a lot of this, actually. And these hosts, female hosts of shows, who've trained a whole generation of women that their job is to be these hostesses. Okay. Okay. And of course, Oprah got, you know, the president elected. All right. So there's a generation of young women now who feel that their brilliance is expressed in asking, jumping in and hogging the spotlight and asking Joe these stupid, inane questions, you know, instead of letting Joe have the spotlight, you see, because he earned it. And Joe is a code for Jesus, okay? They don't want Jesus to have the spotlight. They want to jump in and hog it. I mean, I'm sure Oprah wants to have Jesus on her show. Hey, Jesus, so where have you been all this time, Jesus? And, you know, she wants to share the spotlight, okay? She thinks that when Jesus comes back, Jesus is going to be on her show. That kind of thing, you know. This is the Zeta Reticulan psychop that's been going on this planet. It's absolutely outrageous, you know. They have no qualifications to be interviewing Jesus. Now, she tried to brush up on A Course in Miracles, like, so she's ready for, you know, like, oh, I have an interview opportunity here, you know. So let me brush up on this and pretend that I'm really some sort of devoted student of it, you know. Superficial. And maybe I can get Eckhart Tolle to help Jesus come on my show. That's how she thinks, you know. Yeah, if I brush up next to these, you know, these people, maybe they have the influence to get Jesus on my show, and then I can really get great ratings, you know. And I'll really be awesome. This is nasty business that's been going on in this world. And the Zeta Reticulans know it. And the Draconians, who they work for. They work for the Draconians, the Reptilians. Those are the two of the nasty players involved in this takeover of this planet. There's a consortium, a corporation that's taking it over. And those are two of the nastier players involved. And of course, then they put this whole thing about activists, you know, where as if you turn down their interview request, you know, you're a bigot, sexist, homophobic, racist. Okay. That's their thing. Oh no, we have the right to share the spotlight. Why? You haven't done the work. Jesus is coming back for those who've done the work of clarification. He's there to put the spotlight on those who've done the work so that you can see this is what you need to do. He's not coming back to be hijacked, to be usurped, for others to jump in the limelight who don't deserve to be there and steal the attention of the planet. So, you know, those little expletives are very expletive, to say the least, and they know what they're doing. I mean, they're trying their very best to mislead the whole world and make believe that, you know, oh yeah, that Jesus is really supporting, you know, the goddess and Jesus are working together, and the flesh and guilt and Jesus are working together, and all you have to do is be an attractive hostess, be a young, beautiful maiden, and that's what, you know, you deserve to share the spotlight with Jesus. In fact, you deserve to host Jesus and be the one who controls the narrative. The host controls the narrative. They're in control. They got the microphone. And I remember some interview, it was with a giant, some player. It was hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. There's some hostess who works for the Giants, and not without talent. I'm not trying, again, I'm not biased against talent, but I'm pointing out how it's being used. And doing an interview with someone, really important interview, and the guy took the microphone from her and says, "Hey, you know, let me interview you. You know, how do you feel about, you know, the Giants winning this very important game? And how do you?" And so the guy, the baseball player, took the microphone and interviewed her, and she was absolutely shocked and stunned and freaked out by it, completely freaked out by it, completely freaked out by it, and says, "You don't do that. I'm the one in charge. I'm the one who asks the questions, not you." So of course, if you're the one asking the questions, you're the one controlling the entire narrative. Duh. Hey, Jesus, where have you been? We want you. I'm telling you to focus on this question. I'm the one deciding what questions you answer. Okay? This is controlling the narrative, folks. And that's exactly what the Zeta Reticulans want to do. They want to control the narrative here. And they know that Jesus will go off their script, and they cannot control his narrative. They're trying to find a way to control his narrative as much as possible. So this, what happened? Is it still recording? I hope so. Yes, it is. Awesome. Because this is awesome stuff. This is awesome. This is juicy, isn't it? This is heavyweight stuff. I mean, this is what you've been waiting for. You've been waiting for, you know, the heavy stuff to fall. And here it is. You know, you're getting it right now. You're getting it. And it's just like, wow. You know, remember, full stop on the wow. You must practice that. That is the whole secret of success, full stop. And Jesus encoded his teachings in the various activities he did in this world. He was showcasing this. This is how you, this is the way that the practice, to practice. Now you can even possibly look at the Eucharist instead of his actual flesh and blood. It symbolizes the condition-free condition, the condition-free condition. It's a condition, right? But we say, wait a minute, that's like bread that didn't happen, you know. There's no yeast in it. It didn't rise, you know. It's like it's a condition, but without conditions, so to speak. So it symbolizes the abiding condition, the condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. This is a way to look at the Eucharist. If you're a Catholic and take that Eucharist and say, Jesus is telling me to abide in the condition-free condition. A lot of goddess paganism guilt has crept into the church, a lot, okay? You got to get free of that. You don't have to get free of the church, but you and your mind need to realize what's going on, that there was good purpose and intention behind it, for sure. No doubt about it. The church has done tremendous good work in the world. They have tried to block the Zeta Reticulans. The church has always known about extraterrestrials, okay? Let's be straight about that. I mean, the presence of extraterrestrials in this world has been since the world began, so to speak. I mean, they've always been messing with stuff here, okay? The church certainly knew about them. There's no question about it. And they tried to block this corporate takeover of this planet. Absolutely, the Roman Catholic Church has probably done more than anyone to try to block this cosmic corporate takeover of the planet. And that's why they instituted all sorts of restrictions and what smart, pragmatic things to do to block it. Plus, they told us we need to practice to get this peace beyond understanding. Okay. That Jesus told us this is there for us. We can have that. And the Eucharist is a way to symbolize the condition-free condition. That keep your attention on this condition-free condition. Keep working at it. ultimately, you know, the church will see what happens. We'll see what happens. You know, ultimately, maybe that in some way it was successful in some way. We're certainly outing the Zeta Reticulans right here. We're outing the whole situation right here, right now. And the Catholic Church did play some role in that, actually. Absolutely. The overall collective culture for 2,000s of years certainly was very, very helpful. Extremely helpful. We would have been absolute patsies. You look at the people who have fallen hook, line, and sinker for this jive. They're not very religious people. A lot of them are atheists, a lot of them are not religious at all, and they don't pay any much attention to it, you know. So they're absolute patsies for it. Look at the ones who have the most resistance. A lot of those are very religious people, which the Zeta Reticulans hate, and are fomenting this climate, a lynch mob crucifying mentality towards all people who are religious. Actually, the attitude of this world now is very crucifying. Mood. The world is in a crucifying mood. Certainly the liberal progressives are in a very crucifying mood. This is what we're getting. There's no question about it. You see this with Mr. Trump. If the laws allowed him, they would crucify him. This man, they'd nail him to a cross right now because he brought up an inconvenient truth. Inconvenient. He pointed in an inconvenient direction, let's put it that way. It was kind of a crude way of doing it, but he pointed in an inconvenient direction. And they just absolutely want to crucify him. They'd crucify Jesus in a minute if they could. Absolutely they would. And this is the work of the Zeta Reticulans and the Draconians, who are, their purpose is to take over this planet and make it their own planet. As one of their important bases to expand their rampage throughout, you know, other areas of the cosmos. They would crucify Jesus in a second. In a New York second, they would do it. Or a New York minute, however you want to say it. I'll say a New York second, they'll do it. They would do it. The Zeta Reticulans are much more clever than that. They're very clever. They love their cleverness. They're in love with cleverness. And so they want to do it in a real slick way, you see. They love doing it in a very sly, slick way, like a leopard. The leopard just doesn't thunder in like an elephant, you know. The leopard sneaks up on its prey. It hides very artfully. And then, just at the right vulnerable moment, they strike with lightning quickness, kill their prey, and drag it off just like that. They're super, super clever at it. The Zeta Reticulans are like leopards. That's why that leopard flag that the POTUS put on his Facebook as the headline of his tweet in his Facebook tweet or something shows that profile of the leopard. That should tell you who you're dealing with right here. You're dealing with the Zeta Reticulans and their operatives, actually. Okay, that's who the world is up against right now. As St. Paul said, we deal not with powers and kings and principalities of this world, but powers and principalities in the high heavens, meaning dimensional entities, Zeta Reticulans, extraterrestrials. He knew exactly what was going on. They were not naive at all. As are we not naive at all either. So this hogging of the spotlight thing, it was bothering me extremely. I said, wow, I'm very upset. I said, this is crazy. This isn't going anywhere. I mean, this is a total takeover. Total takeover. And this has been planned. I was actually told when I was young by a young woman, and she explained to me what her plan was, and she told me exactly what she was going to do, and it's exactly what's happened. She says, we're going to take over. We're going to go through into the media, and in sports especially, and we're going to dominate you guys, absolutely dominate through the media and how we present you, etc. We're going to be in charge of you. And she was young. She told me, this is what we're going to do. So I was aware that there was this plan, and now it's absolutely come to fruition now. Absolutely come to fruition. You shift to a sports show right now, and you know, important sports news, a lot of times it's two women now, completely controlling the whole thing. And again, what have they done to deserve the spotlight that is, we're only there watching this show because of the heroic efforts of our champions, so to speak, those who have demonstrated the highest skill in what they're doing. And then we know it's quite difficult what they do. It takes great skill and effort and dedication and blood, sweat, and tears. And we're only watching that show because of them. You know, they're the ones who earned our attention. These bimbos did absolutely nothing to earn our attention, except what, being born a woman, you know, and growing up, you know, primping in front of mirrors, and of course they go get a degree in communications. Oh wow, you know, oh, that's really awesome. That's really difficult, huh? Your parents pay your way, you get a degree in communications, and now you get to host with a microphone, and you know what words you can't use, but they're actually fairly skilled knowing how to control the interview. Let's give them that. Let's give the devil its due. They're very, very clever at knowing what to avoid in the interview, how to quash any line of answering they don't like. They are skillful at that. So they're skillful in control, very adept at control. But of course, we don't want to hear their control. We want to see what the champion has to say. We want to get insights into what makes a champion. What makes a champion? Okay, this is what we're looking for. What makes a champion? We want them to freely express the insights in that. Instead, the bimbo is controlling the narrative, and she crushes anything that is not within the script of narrative. So they're very well trained to do the will of the Zeta Reticulans. There's no question about it. But that's not anything that anybody should applaud at all. In fact, they should be thoroughly ashamed of what they're doing. Thoroughly ashamed of it. And should cease and desist. Cease and desist. Just like the Supreme Court ruling on marriage should be vacated. It should absolutely be vacated. Okay, that's my how I look at it. It's illegitimate. You got four skirts on there doing the will of the Zeta Reticulans, who show no genius for law whatsoever. Okay. It would be easier to take if it was a ruling. First of all, it was unanimous. It was 5-4, completely on partisan lines between conservatives and radical progressives. Those four women on the court are radical progressives. They're only there because they're radical progressives. They're only there because they're doing the will of their puppet masters, who are the Zeta Reticulans, actually. And so it's a completely illegitimate vote. Completely. There's no law behind it at all. None. So it's illegitimate, and we look forward to have it being vacated, absolutely being vacated. It has no real legitimacy at all. It's all part of the psychop that's going on, that the Zeta Reticulans are involved in. They're termites. Let's put it in the nicest way, they're termites. Okay, now, do you want your house that you spent a ton of money on, or been paid the mortgage for 30 years, and you got this beautiful house? Do you want to invite a bunch of termites into your wood foundation of the house? And do you want to invite the termites and say, "Hey, gee, termites, I'm so happy you're here, and I'm just going to pretend you don't exist"? And then we did this house once that the whole house was completely termited. You push the house strong enough that just the whole thing just crumbles, just collapses and crumbles. You pick up a 6x12, you know, by 12-foot header board that should weigh, you know, 250 pounds. It weighs like 15 pounds because there's nothing but dust there. There's nothing but dust there. So these Zeta Reticulans and the draconian extraterrestrials, Cosmic Corporate Corporation, have termited this planet. They're termites. They're termites. That's the best you can say about them, actually. And so we got some very lovely, attractive termites who are skilled at being termites, termiting the situation. You say, "Gee, guys, you shouldn't mind. Look how attractive I am. Why are you objecting? Don't you like looking at me?" You know, say, "Actually, not in this situation, we don't at all. We want to get a valuable insight into what makes a champion and how we can, you know, what's dedication all about? Can you inspire us to be dedicated in some way, you know? Now, actually, we don't really want to look at you in this situation at all. So quit hogging the spotlight, you bimbo. You know, that's the best we can say about it, you expletive, you know. Shame on you. Shame on you. You should be absolutely ashamed of yourself for going along with this wicked, wicked termiting of this world, termiting the spiritual will of this world, to take the high road that Jesus pointed out to us. Because I'm here as a witness saying that the high road of Jesus is legitimate. I have reached the pinnacle of understanding about what this high road is about. And he's absolutely true. What he's told us is absolutely true. And so it's totally justified for a planet to take the high road and to resist termiting by these expletive termites, you know, that termite the spiritual will on the planet, try to take it over and turn it to, you know, hedonistic lusts of the flesh, trying to expiate this imaginary guilt, thinking that they can build a perfect utopian kingdom of the flesh. You know, that is absolute lie. It is an absolute lie. This is the work of the devil, the work of Satan, as Jesus put it. And this is what we absolutely have the right to resist, this, because the goal that Jesus points out to us can be reached. Absolutely can be reached, but it takes dedication. It takes dedication. It takes hard work and dedication. Like these champions that we look at, we know they've dedicated their life to being the best. And we want to hit that message. You know, we don't want some bimbo that's gone to some cheap communication school. You know, I got a communications major, therefore I'm hireable because I got a college degree, so that then these multinational corporations will put them on and as hosts of these shows. You know, we don't want them. We don't want to see them. They have nothing to offer us. Nothing to offer us. What are their great accomplishments of a supreme dedication? You know, don't have them. They don't have them. They put on some nice lip gloss. That's what they've done. Wow, that's, you know, we don't, you know, what kind of accomplishment is that? It's nothing. It's nothing. Anybody can stand in front of a mirror and put some lip gloss on, okay? This is absolutely ridiculous, okay? It's obscene. It's absolutely obscene what's going on. Absolutely obscene. And that's putting it in the nicest way possible. It's absolutely obscene. So I hope you're enjoying the video. This is like, you know, got to take the gloves off now, because I found out just how vicious these little expletives are. And to try and con me like this, you know, in such a, I couldn't believe that they would be so, that they would try to involve one of the greatest teachers, spiritual teachers ever been on this planet, would have no conscience but to try to rig up a scam in this way, to try to hog the spotlight from Jesus. That they would willing to do that just shows they have no shame whatsoever. I couldn't believe someone would have, you know, we don't understand someone has no shame. They have no shame. These little expletives have no shame whatsoever. None. And I've talked to some of those who are totally under the influence of them, even claim that they were the Zeta Reticulans. And I asked them questions. I said, who do you feel is a divine being that you have the utmost reverence towards? What are the saints you have? And they said, we don't have any. We don't need any. We don't have any. That's ridiculous, you know. They told me flat out, you know, they give no value at all to Jesus, none. So they feel free to use him whatever, any way they want to. They feel no value to Ananda Mayama. They feel absolutely free to use her in any scam that they can try to use. No shame whatsoever. And that's what we're up against. They're shameless. But us, those here on this planet, we do have shame, you know. So shame on those who have capitulated and are playing along with this. Absolute shame on you. It's totally obscene. Stop doing this obscenity. Drop the obscenity. You know, quit. Quit your job. Get another job. Drop the obscenity. You got no business trying to hog the spotlight. And ultimately their goal is to hog the spotlight from Jesus and Jesus' apostles, those who Jesus says, hey, you've done the work, you know. Help me out now. Help me spread the word. Okay? Those are ones that Jesus picked. The goddess doesn't pick those. Jesus picks his own apostles. Okay? Based on absolute merit. On merit, not because you're in a tight skirt with lip gloss, okay? That's not merit. That has nothing to do with merit. That's obscene to suggest that as merit. It's those who have done the tough, difficult work, and it's extraordinarily difficult. It is just ridiculously difficult. The work that I've done is ridiculously difficult. But I did it, see? That's the key. Did it. Thanks to Jesus, and thanks to Ananda Mayama, thanks to Ramana Maharshi, thanks to Longchenpa, thanks to many teachers, thanks to the Catholic, Roman Catholic Church throughout the ages, thanks to the Protestant Church, thanks to all the religions of the world, thanks to the total flow of spiritual will and effort on this planet, I was able to get up to the mountaintop and now see, wow, this is the root of it. Holy cow. To abide in the condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. The bimbos had absolutely nothing to do with it. Zero. So they have absolutely no business whatsoever on the stage. Zero business on the stage being there. It's a complete obscenity, them being on the stage like that. Total complete obscenity. And we should not allow for total complete obscenities in this culture. If we do, then we are simply inviting the Zeta Reticulans and Draconians and the cosmic corporate culture to completely take over this planet, and you will suffer the consequences of that. You will suffer the consequences of that, which is misdirection. And you will continue to expiate and try to atone for this imagined guilt with your death, with your continued death and the death of others. You will live in a culture of death is the price you pay. You will live in a continued culture of death, plain and simple. If you allow this total obscenity to take place, if you say, no, I've got to split attention, it's only fair. Someone who did nothing to deserve the attention, I have to split the attention with someone who did everything to deserve that attention. What kind of idiocy? That's an obscenity. That's an obscenity. That's an idiotic obscenity. So you must reject that. You must reject that. You must say that, I will not do that. I will not do that. I have spiritual will. I can choose where to put my attention, and I have the right to be intelligent. I have the right to be truly reasonable. I have the right to be pragmatic. I have a right to say, the culture of death can be let go. I don't need it. Jesus told me I don't need it, and I believe Jesus is right. We don't need the dream of death at all. We do not need the dream of death at all. It has zero necessity for us. Absolutely no application and no necessity for us at all. None. Okay, so I deserve to put my attention on that which knows this to be true. Okay, and those who don't know it to be true, have done no work to clarify this, they don't deserve my attention. They don't deserve it. And if they're asking for it, they're engaged in extreme obscenity. And I don't want to be an extremely obscene person with my attention. I don't want that. That's not what I really want. That's not what I really want. And you can decide, just decide for yourself. This is the key between the sheep and the goats, okay? The sheep are going towards freedom from death-based culture, okay? From death-based world, from death-based universe, from this dream of death. They're going to freedom from that. The goats will remain immersed in a culture of death. They will remain immersed in a culture of death. That's their payment. That's their reward for trying to, you know, hogging the spotlight and being completely obscene. That's their reward. For censoring, for cutting off, for blocking everything that they're trying to do right now. Their reward is a death-based culture, a death culture. That's the reward that they get for that. And it's going to be a very bitter pill for sure, as it always is. And everybody's like, oh, I don't want to get these bimbos mad at me. They'll be upset. Some news lady will not let me get on the news, will cut me off or vilify me, or I will be attacked and being a racist or sexist. And everybody's like, oh. Now, we're not dealing with racism or sexism or homophobia or bigotry or anything. We're dealing with a complete, total obscenity is what we're dealing with. And we're dealing with these nasty little expletives who are trying to, you know, drag us into a perpetual culture of death. That's a total obscenity. We're dealing with trying to completely ignore Jesus Christ, which is a total obscenity. Okay, we're dealing with being pressured to ignore our true identity, which is a total obscenity. That's what we're really dealing with. So you can sweep all those, you know. What are those talking points, you know? You're racist, you're a racist. You can sweep all that away. What we're dealing with here is immeasurably more important than that. We're dealing with a total obscenity is what we're dealing with here, folks. So you got to realize that and say, no, I'm not going to go with that total obscenity. I will not. I will not. And that's cut and dried. You're one of the sheep. You're not one of the goats. You're not one of the goats. You know, you don't want to get in bed with those slimy little expletives, really. They're technocratic dreams, you know, they're technocratic dreams. And yet people are falling along like lemmings, you know, like lemmings. You don't need to be a lemming, an obscene lemming. Being a lemming is a total obscenity. It's a total obscenity. And, you know, they shouldn't allow total obscenities on the air, should they? So what they're doing shouldn't be allowed, shouldn't be broadcast on television or movies or music entertainment or whatever. Shouldn't be allowed at all, because we shouldn't allow total obscenities on the air. And 50 years ago, we wouldn't allow any of this on the air. Almost 100% of what is being presented to us as culture right now, 50 years ago, 60 years ago, none of this would have been allowed. It would have been seen as a total obscenity, and they were absolutely right. And it would have been the Catholic Church, and it would have been the Presbyterian, and it would have been the Protestant churches. I think I might have said Presbyterian previously. I meant Protestant churches. Protestant churches, it would have been Islam would have said that. Hinduism would have said that. Buddhism would have said that. All religions of the world, Judaism would have said that. They would all would have said, this is a total obscenity. We will not allow it. Almost 100% of modern culture right now, 60 years ago, would have been viewed as a total obscenity, and none of it would have been allowed. That is how far we have fallen. This is it. And we've allowed it. We've allowed it. Why? Because of some, you know, sexy bimbos. Say, hey, look at this. Don't you want to look at this? Oh, well, you can't have this unless you look at this. If you don't look at this, we won't give you this, you know. What utter obscenity that is, isn't it? That you can't have truth unless we match it up with the flesh, you know. We won't give you anything unless you first get the flesh. It's extortion, it's blackmail, it's an obscenity. Those people should be run out of town. They shouldn't have any access to broadcasting anything. And you don't got to wait for the Supreme Court to make any stupid decisions. They're incapable of making any good decisions at this point. And nor should they. They have no moral authority whatsoever. Okay, the Supreme Court has legalistic authority, quote-unquote. And even that, they're complete fools at that. But they have no moral authority whatsoever. They have zero moral authority. They cannot rule on moral authority at all. We have the right, each one of us has the right, to rule on moral authority. Okay? The Holy Spirit has the right. We have a right to see what is obscenity and what is not. Okay? Absolutely we have that right. And so we exercise that right. Ultimately, we're our own Supreme Court. Period. So the Zeta Reticulans are all celebrating, you know. They say, we got them. No, they don't. Not so fast, you little slimy expletives. Not so fast here. We'll wait and see what Jesus does. We'll wait and see what Jesus is going to do. Is what we're going to find out what Jesus has to do. And you're finding out right here. A little bit of it, aren't you? Yeah. We're going to out you out of the closet, little slimy expletives. We're going to out you out of the closet, out of your little Zeta Reticulan extraterrestrial closet. We're going to out you. And we're going to shine the spotlight and saying, hey, you know, you didn't fool us at all. You didn't fool us at all. What you're doing is a completely obscene. And you're not going to hog the spotlight with Jesus. Not at all. Not at all. Are you? You don't see some bimbo host here with me, huh? You don't see someone co-hosting with me, do you? No, you don't. So you're going to take your medicine. We'll see what kind of medicine Jesus has for you. And we're going to abide in the condition-free condition. We are going to abide in the condition for a condition. Tough luck. You're out of luck. Too bad. You know, go on with your culture of death, with your death-based culture if that's what you want. You're not going to drag us in down into that pit. Yeah, you don't like being talked to like this? Too bad. This is how obscenity is talked to. This is how we talk to obscenity, total obscenity. That's how we talk with it. You don't like it? Then change your position. It's that simple. Very simple, isn't it? Not complicated at all. But your love of cunning deceit doesn't like that. Doesn't like it. It says, no, I have to be cunning. I love telling lies, cunning deceitfulness. I can't exist without that. You know, no. You know, the truth is very simple for everyone. It's for you. It's for me. It's for everyone. It's for all of us. There's no such thing as guilt. It's completely made up. There's no need to atone for guilt. No need to atone for a completely non-existent, made-up guilt. It doesn't exist. And our continuity fear about failing to change the will of God, we can cure that through abiding in the condition-free condition. The condition-free condition. Everyone is invited to this party. Okay, the condition-free condition. Even those little expletives are invited to it. Okay? They have to abide in it. Okay? It's not a matter of trying to hog the spotlight with us. It's abiding in it. Yeah, this thing that they're doing, I've been aware of it for a long time, and it's just sickening what they're doing. Everywhere you see these skirts with microphones going to any possible situation where men have done something great and interviewing them and presenting it on YouTube, present whatever. You know, this is their obsession. People don't realize how effective this is. This is very sneaky, stealthy, and supremely effective in collapsing spiritual will on the planet. Very, very effective. Someone went interviewed one of the devotees of Anandamayi. As a woman doing the interview, she just completely made the interview about her. It's unbelievable. Just terrible. Kept cutting in, say, "Wait a minute, you're not saying what I really want you to say." Let me bring the conversation back to this. You know, the guy would say, "No, but this is what Ma told you." What do you mean? Oh, no. Okay. Well, look. Okay, now I want to ask you this question. Just cutting it off, distorting, misrepresenting, like that. Giving her narrative, she wanted the guy to say what she wanted him to say. And this is what these skirts are doing. They are insisting that whoever they're interviewing say what they want them to say. And they're training everybody to say, "Look, you say what we want you to say, or else we're not going to interview you at all. Or we're going to claim that you're sexist, or that you offended us, or something, right? You're offensive. We find that offensive. If you don't say exactly what they want you to say they find it offensive. Well, guess what? I find them totally obscene, which is way beyond offensive, isn't it? I find what they're doing to be totally obscene." Okay, so that trumps any offensiveness they want to claim that you didn't say what I told you to say or what I want you to say, and you made me uncomfortable because you might expose me as the fraud that they are, you know. They might expose, you know, I'm afraid of being exposed for working for the Zeta Reticulans and terminating the culture. I'm afraid I might be outed, and that makes me feel uncomfortable. So you have no right to make me feel uncomfortable. Really? We don't have a right to out total obscenity? Yes, we do. Yes, we do, and yes, we will. Plain and simple. And yes, we are doing that. Jesus said, "I didn't come to bring peace to the world. I came to bring a sword to separate those who wanted to repent and those who wanted to continue on with a death culture." He said, so there's a parting of the ways. I came to bring a sword of division to divide it, those, so we wouldn't continue on in this stupid dance of trying to combine the two. Combine guilt and no such thing as guilt. You can't combine it. They're mutual exclusives. Either there's guilt or there isn't. You can't be halfway pregnant. Either you're pregnant or you're not. Either we have guilt or there isn't any guilt. And Jesus says there is no guilt, plain and simple. He's completely unambiguous about this. Absolutely has stated it over and over. There is no such thing as guilt, period. Absolutely unequivocal and unwavering on this. Okay? That's it. That sets the agenda. It's Jesus that sets the agenda. It's truth that sets the agenda. When I say Jesus, I mean the confessor of truth. It's truth that sets the agenda. It's truth that sets the agenda. Okay? It's truth that sets the agenda. And it's so Jesus, as one who is perfect in the truth, we can say pragmatically, we can say it's Jesus that sets the agenda here, okay? Not these info babe, these bimbos, okay? These lipstick skirts, they don't set the agenda. And their insistence that they have equal right to set the agenda, Jesus is completely obscene. It is Jesus that sets the agenda. It is not lies that set the agenda. It is truth that sets the agenda for us. Because we are children of truth. We are not children of lies. We've never been children of lies. It's not like we're both children of truth and children of lies. We have a shared parentage. We don't have a shared parentage. We have one creator, and that's God the Father. One creator. We don't have two creators of us. We are not children of both lies and truth. We're children of truth only, period. So it's truth that sets the agenda for us, period. And the attempt to have lies hog the spotlight is completely, totally obscene. End of story. How are we doing here? Pretty good. Oh, doing great. Doing great. Feeling great. Feeling great. This is we're moving. It's moving day, isn't it? It's moving day. it's wind day. Wind day. In golf they call the Saturday moving day, and then Sunday, of course, it's wind day. You know, you're in the back nine. You've gotta perform. Period. If you don't, you're not going to win. So we're going on the back nine here, and we're making birdies here. I mean, we are winning. This is what winning is all about. We are winning. And our goal, of course, is to take refuge and abidance in the conditioned-free condition. The conditioned, condition-free condition. Just hear that and say, hey, there is such a situation from a symbolic perceptual standpoint, which is what we're still working with, right? But there is, it is possible to take refuge from symbols, projection, perception, lies, all of this. Even while we're here in this world, it is possible to take refuge, even while we're here in this world. And hopefully we won't remain here much longer, but if we do, we do. So we can take refuge. Ramana Maharshi showed us a great example of the capacity we have to take refuge, truly take refuge, where we simply cannot be termited or undermined in any way. We remain in bliss, remain in perfect tranquility and calm, and nothing drastic can affect us in any way, cannot affect us. Take refuge in the condition-free condition. Take refuge in the condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. And give, let Jesus and those who are appointed by Jesus to spread this message, let them have the spotlight. Insist they have the spotlight, and insist that those who try to jump in and hog the spotlight and upstage them, insist that that's a total obscenity, and demand that they step down, they step aside, demand that they step aside. Refuse to put up with that. Refuse to put up with any of that. Demand that they step aside. Shame them. Absolutely shame them. Demand they step aside. We are not defeated. We are not beaten here. It may seem that we're down right now, but we will have a resurgence here. We will have a resurgence. We're not beaten. In fact, we're the ones who are going to win. We're the ones who are going to win this. But we keep our eye on the prize, okay, which is abidance in the condition-free condition. Abidance in the condition-free condition. And this will begin to... There'll be some acceptance, you know. How do you understand that intellectually? You can't really. Not very well, right? Don't worry. It's there. It's there. As I gave you the analogy of this vast ocean of dark paint, pigment-like, where no pigment that's added changes it at all. Throw a bunch of red in there. It doesn't change the black at all. The red is just absorbed into the black. It just makes the black blacker, you know, darker. All it does, whatever they throw in, it just makes the dark darker. So they can't do anything about it. And in terms of dark, I mean no reaction, is what I mean. It's a symbol for no conditions arising, no reaction arising. Nothing changing, nothing changing, nothing changing. We can do it, and we can keep that aim. Keep our eye on the prize. We can keep our eyes on the prize, and we must keep our eye on the prize. We must not react to the drastic situations. We must continue to keep our eye on the prize. We are not beaten. Even though 99% of the planet might be aligned against us at this point, there's a lot of people who are stunned at this point and by the blitzkrieg of those little expletives, and which has been a severe blitzkrieg, and the blitzkrieg will be even worse coming up. It's like Nazi Germany going to Austria, you know, first and said, wow, it's a blitzkrieg. And then everyone said, okay, they'll stop there. Well, guess what? They didn't stop there, did they? We've already had a number of blitzkriegs happen. And we think, wow, that was terrible. But oh, okay, well, maybe that's all they're after. No, they're after the whole pie. They're after the whole pie. Absolutely they are. They're not going to stop their blitzkriegs. You know, Hitler made a pact with Stalin that we would never invade Russia. Yeah, right. And then a couple months later, full-on Operation Barbarossa, a complete blitzkrieg of Russia, right? They can't be trusted at all. You trust a leopard? A man-eating leopard? You're going to trust that leopard? No, you cannot trust that leopard. Once it's got a taste of a blitzkrieg, you cannot trust that leopard anymore. So, abide in the condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. Abide in the condition-free condition. Even though the table things seem to be against us, the tide can turn. The tide will turn. The tide will turn. The tide will turn. You start to say, wait a minute, get back on your feet. You know, I'm not so knocked out as I thought I was. I'm not so knocked out as I thought I was. I'm not so knocked out as I thought I was. I'm not so knocked out as I thought I was. I got more power than I thought I had. I'm not so intimidated now by those, you know, like feces-throwing simians, you know, or try to throw any accusation against you, possible to see something that might stick. You know, they hurl every possible accusation. You're this, you're this, you're the race, you know, you're rah, rah, rah. They're just throwing everything they can at you, you know, screaming and gibbering and screaming at you and throwing it at you and hoping that some of it might stick, you know, is all they're doing. Yeah, well, none of it sticks because we're saying that they're totally obscene. And that's what sticks. They know it. That's what sticks. And shame on them. Absolute shame on them. Repent, repent, repent. Period. Nothing else to say. Shame on you. You're totally obscene. Shame on you. Repent. Period. Simple message. Simple message. Repent or face the consequences of a death culture. Face the consequences of a death culture. Let's see how well you dress that up in a tight skirt and lipstick. How much you like embracing that death culture. Hopefully this video goes viral. I hope it goes viral. Maybe you can help it go viral. You know, this is, you know, a very important video that people hear this and they realize, hey, maybe we're not defeated. Maybe there's a light somewhere. Maybe Jesus is back. Maybe we have a chance. Maybe we can push back. Maybe we can take refuge from the drasticness to come. Maybe we don't need to succumb to that. You see, this is hope. This is the air of hope. Breathing the air of hope is super important. These are like smelling salts. So hopefully you can help make this video go viral, you know, and people start to hear this and say, hey, I think I'm coming out of a terror. I think someone almost knocked me out and I'm regaining my consciousness now. Wow, I'm regaining my backbone. I'm woozy, but I'm getting on my feet and I think I can, you know, dance away from whoever's trying to pummel me. Like, you know, we've been pummeled. We've been pummeled by a blitzkrieg in this world. All by design. I've been warning everyone about this. Warning, 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 warning. There'll come a time when the buildup turns into a blitzkrieg. And then that gets even worse and worse and worse. So we're pushing back. Flee, you know, flee from the total obscenity. Turn away from it. Turn away from it. And the ones that are doing this, they're guilty. They know. I mean, they're ashamed of what they're doing, but they won't admit to it. They can't, you know, they can't admit to it. So don't waste your time, you know, pleading too much. Just tell them, you know, this is where it's at. This is the truth. You got to repent. Period. Repent or face the consequences. You know, your consequences, you'll be embracing a death culture. Missing out on the opportunity for death-free universe, death-free realm, death-free culture. You'll be missing out on that. You'll miss out on it. How sad will that make you? You'll miss out on it. Miss your opportunity. Now, of course, the opportunity is perpetually there, but it will seem as though you've missed your opportunity because you'll invest in another cycle of death culture, thinking, you know, embrace it and go to bed with it and think that this is, you know, this is it. And you'll have severe buyer regrets, severe regrets. So it's better to back away at the edge than to go off the edge and then suffer severe regrets later. It's far better to not take that last step and to back away. Abide in what? The condition-free condition. The condition-free condition. Isn't that beautiful just to hear that? Yes, I can abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, there is a condition-free condition. Yes, I can abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, I am abiding. Yes, I already am abiding in the condition-free condition. Yes, I already am abiding in the condition-free condition. Yes, I am already abiding in the condition-free condition. Music to our ears. Better than any symphony. Music to our ears. This is why I've put all my effort into this instead of continuing to compose music. I said, no. There's got to be something better than music. There's got to be something that's even better than hearing, you know, these big symphonies. Abide in the condition-free condition. That is better music to our ears than any song could ever be. And this is what I realized. I said, it doesn't matter how great a composer I am. There's no way I can ever compose any music that's going to sound even remotely as good as the gospel of Jesus Christ sounds. Abide in the condition-free condition is the sweetest music we could ever hear. It is absolutely the sweetest music we'd ever hear. So, this is what I'm composing now. I'm involved in apostolic composition, which is the truth. Spreading the truth, that's the music we really want to hear. Yes, I can abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, I am abiding in the condition-free condition. Yes, I am already abiding in the condition-free condition. Yes, I can abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, I can. Yes, I will abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, I will abide in the condition-free condition. Yes, I will abide in the condition-free condition. So, we continue on. Let this sink in. It's go time. There's no question about it. It's go time. You can do it. You can put your eye on the prize. You can get back on your feet. You don't have to be intimidated. Let me tell you something. Jesus isn't intimidated at all. You know, those little expletives might be able to intimidate everyone in the world, but they cannot intimidate Jesus in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest, but all those draconian reptiles huffing and puffing and screaming and shouting, and, you know, they cannot intimidate Jesus in the slightest bit. All those little gray little expletives who are so offended, you know, that we don't respect them the way they want to be respected and don't respect their cleverness and stuff, you know, they don't intimidate or fool Jesus one bit. Not even the slightest bit. All those who claim that there is guilt, you know, we have to learn to properly atone for our guilt. They don't fool Jesus one bit. Jesus knows there's no such thing as guilt. Never has been. The only way there could ever be guilt is if we could actually change the will of God, and that's completely impossible. Never happened. Can never happen. So there's no guilt whatsoever. So they don't fool Jesus one bit. They might pull the wool over the eyes of everybody on this planet. They can't pull the wool over the eyes of Jesus one bit. Not one bit. And Jesus is our friend. He's our brother. So he shares the truth with us. He's available to us. As he has said, I'm back. I'm available to everyone. This is what he said, May 1st. I'm back. I'm available to everyone. Now my full attention is here. I'm ready to relate to anyone who wants to relate with me, wants to interact, wants to acknowledge I'm here, etc. I'm back. So here we go. Here we go. So, keep in mind, Jesus is not intimidated, and you don't have to be either. You don't have to be either, because he'll tell you, hey, you can take refuge in condition-free condition, the condition-free condition. You can take refuge in it. Take refuge in it, condition-free condition. And this will solve this intermediate continuity issue that we have of thinking that failure has a condition associated with it. Okay? We reason tells us it doesn't, of course, but because we've been believing that it has for so long, we're not willing to give up just say, wow, zero is really is zero. There's no condition. That's it. Poof. And, you know, right into isness, immediately complete isness forevermore. We're not quite ready to do that directness. So there is this way to abide in the condition, free condition. We say, yeah, failure has a condition. What's that? What? No condition. See, that's the condition. Condition, free condition. That no matter what kind of condition you try to give it, that's not it either. See, it's like that. It's like, wow, none of these conditions are the conditions of failure. Not a single one. I'm experiencing it. I say, wow, that doesn't bring about a condition at all. That doesn't bring about. So it's kind of still time-based. You know, still say everything that's happening, that doesn't produce any condition at all. And so that we experience this, and we say, wow, nothing produces any condition. And ultimately, then we say, hey, that's because failure doesn't have a condition associated with it. And then we set down that belief entirely. Meanwhile, we can, as we're here, we can practice and just allow whatever happens, that doesn't produce any condition in him whatsoever. So that's awesome. It's absolutely awesome. How are we doing here? 2:14. Well, so far it's letting us, giving us some rope here, some slack here, so we can keep going. I have no idea when it's going to stop. It just does so at its own whim, actually. Because I didn't program in 4 gigabytes. So it's just giving us, you know, whatever it feels like giving us. It's capricious as far as, if I don't program it in, it just, at some point I'll just say, okay, that's it. Yeah. So abide in the condition, free condition. Whatever happens, gee, that didn't change my condition at all. Oh, that happened too. That didn't change my condition either. That didn't bring about any condition in me at all. That, this too. Oh, the leaves are blowing. That doesn't bring any condition in me at all. I still feel without any conditions, condition free. And yet our attention is on this, we're interested, like, wow, nothing's causing any ripples, you know, nothing's causing any change in how I feel. This is amazing. This is amazing. I love this. This is quite interesting. I'm very interested in this. And so our attention can be maintained that way. So abide in the condition, free condition. Abide in the condition, free condition. Don't try to struggle with this too. Just let it the impact. Just say, ah, yeah, okay, I'll just let that impact. I'll just get used to being impacted this way. And then in the future, you can be impacted again and even stronger, and it'll help you even more. Just say, yeah. Preach the gospel. Please preach the gospel. Love it. I'm not intimidated anymore. I want to hear this. I want to keep my eye on the prize. I can't abide in the condition, free condition. I can take refuge there. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I have. Go, yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I already have. Okay? This is how it goes. Oh, yes, I can. It exists. I can exist. I can do it. Yes, I will. I have the will to do it. Yes, I already have. I am doing it. You know? This is how it goes. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I already have. Yes, I can. Yes, I will. Yes, I already have. So we'll see what the Holy Spirit will do with this video. I never can tell. And I just trust in the Holy Spirit. You know, there's reasons why there's not so many viewers. Probably the intimidation on me is too much. The responsibility would be too much. I'd back down and try to be a populist, you know. But I think I've crossed the Rubicon on this video right here. You realize I'm not a populist at all. If you're looking for a populist, look somewhere else. Looking for a demagogue, look somewhere else. Okay. So I've crossed the Rubicon and said, look, this is what I stand for, period. Period. Yeah, they thought it'd be easy, didn't they? Maybe it's not going to be as easy as those little expletives thought it'd be so easy. And they just get their way so easy. Maybe it's not going to be as easy as they thought it would be. And that's good news. Maybe their computers weren't quite programmed properly, right? They missed a few variables. some key variables. Maybe they underestimated Jesus, didn't they? Yeah. Didn't quite program Jesus into their computers properly. So they've been following their computerized script, thinking this is bound to work. And then at some point say, uh-oh, it's not quite working the way that the computer told us it would work. We need to go back, we need to tweak it here. Let's tweak it some here. And whoops, the tweak didn't quite work either. Yeah, they're all hive mind, robotic, follow this computer script as if it were God. Thinking that this they have the answer, can't fail them, you know. Well, they'll be very surprised then. They may have to junk their computers. Say, we can never program these things right. Yeah, guess what? You can't. That's right. Technocratic society will never succeed. Guess what? That's right. Technocratic civilization. What a joke. What a total failed joke. Never has worked and never will. So we have a limit on the video, the time. It's 2:20 right now. If we go full, it's about another 10 minutes. If you've really picked up on the intensity of this video, you're probably just like, whoa, 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 whoa. As I am, you know. This is the most intense video I've ever done. It's the most intense video I've ever heard from anybody. By a long shot. So, yeah, it's like, holy cow. It's a treat, you know, from Jesus, really. It's a treat. Here you go. A little bit of intensity. A little bit of good intensity. It's like, hey, this I like this. This is really cool. So bring in this intensity, you know, well, let those who can do it, let them do it. Let those who can do it, let them do it. People will know. They'll be able to tell who's really bringing it. They'll be able to tell. Just like a musical group, you can tell who's really bringing it. I was listening to a band last night, and they're really bringing it. Really good. They're really. I don't mean a live band. YouTube, a song on YouTube. They're really bringing it. They're really good. You can tell. I mean, they're one of the best. I'm not going to give them publicity by saying because music isn't where it's at all. You know, spiritual talk is where it's at. Spiritual discourse is where it's at. Spiritual, you know, that's where it's at. Take refuge in the condition-free condition. That's where it's at. But, you know, people can tell who's bringing it and who isn't. So if you can't really bring it, then listen to those who can. You know, this is the thing. Don't muddy the situation up. You know, like a million bands, say, divide everyone's attention. You know, it's better if people put their attention on a really, really good band, because then they know, oh, this is, we understand this is real expertise we're listening to. This is high, high quality. The other stuff is a bunch of junk. Don't listen to a bunch of junk. Don't waste your time on junk. Don't say, well, I got to give an equal listen to junk. No, you don't. That's obscene again. That's the Zeta Reticulans obscene program scheme. Is waste your time on a bunch of junk. Don't waste your time on junk. Find out who's really bringing it, and then put your attention there, because that's you'll get the song you want to hear then. I'm only taping because I feel I'm bringing it. If I felt I'm not bringing it, then what's the point in taping? You know. So I'm under pressure. I've got to make sure I really bring it. Otherwise, you know, I'm just muddying things up. Jesus is here to bring it, to really bring it, to bring the truth. Okay, he's not here to be wishy-washy and all muddy and, you know, muddy the water. No, came to bring a sword of dividing the wheat from the tares. You know, from the weeds, wheat from the weeds. Separate the wheat from the weeds. Sheep from the goats. He's coming. Let's make a clear delineation here. What side of the fence are you on? There's no fence to sit on, really. It's an imaginary fence. Either there's guilt or there isn't. What side of the fence are you on? That's what Jesus is all about. He pressures us. He absolutely pressures us. The great teachers put a lot of pressure on their students, you know? They pressure you. Say, what side of the fence are you on? There's no two ways about it. There's no two ways about it. Claiming that, well, I'm guilty, but here's a way to solve the guilt. That's dualism. Saying, yes, we succeeded in changing God's will, and now we have this guilt. You know, that's dualism. It's not true. Either there's guilt or there isn't. Either we changed God's will or we didn't. There's no two ways about it whatsoever. So this is like a new art form here, really, you know, that people are not used to. It's really intense truth here, apostolic intensity. They're not used to it. But, hey, time to get used to it. It's like it's the new high culture, actually, here in this world. It's the new high culture. The true high culture, not that obscenity of the drug culture, which is, again, totally obscene. To call drug culture high culture is absolutely obscene. And those who go along with that, shame on you. Absolutely shame on you. Plain and simple. Repent. Repent. And listen to true high culture. Apostolic high culture. You know. Get used to that and you will turn away from drugs for sure. You say, ah, what a joke drugs are. What a joke. What a pathetic, obscene joke they are. Just repent and start paying attention. Repent and pay attention. And get used to it. Familiarity is the key. Repentance has everything to do with familiarity and saying, wow, okay, I need to start getting familiar with the truth. I'm not going to just do it in a day. Familiarity isn't born in a day. It's born every day. It's the everydayness that gives birth to familiarity. It's the everydayness that gives birth to familiarity. And then familiarity is the leverage that you need. Someday you'll be an apostle too, of Jesus. Absolutely, everybody will. And from different traditions, you can say you'll be apostle of truth. Whoever you want to say, you'll be apostle of truth. I use the term Jesus because it's his turn. It's his time now. He's the one who came back. Okay? He's the one that came back as he said he would. So it's his turn on the stage now. Absolutely, it's his time on the stage, so that's why I'm highlighting Jesus. He's done the work. He's prepared the way. He has prepared the way. So, he brought in A Course in Miracles. He brought in Journey Bound Words, The Other Voice. He did a lot of groundwork. He did a ton of work to pave the way for his return. So, everybody give him his due. Give him his due. Give him his time on stage. Give your attention. Give your attention. He brings high apostolic culture with him. He brings high apostolic culture with him. This is the new high culture, the true high culture. Lovely day today. Great day today, July 5th, 2015. We're bringing the juice, we're bringing the high apostolic culture to those who have the ears to hear it. Those who have repented. To those who have repented, and are therefore getting with the program of familiarity, the everydayness of it, and realizing, hey, I can get with this new high culture. I like this better in music, actually. This is way better in music. I gave up music. Absolutely, I gave up a lot of stuff in life. I said, this is better. This is better. It doesn't mean that I won't listen to a song occasionally, not very often, but it's no longer my focus of attention at all. I gave it up. If I can give up music, you can give up whatever's holding you back. That is for sure. You can do it, because this is more attractive. It's more attractive. It's what you really want to hear. Yeah, I can take, I have, take refuge in the condition-free condition. Okay? This is where it's at. This is music to your spiritual ears. Okay? It may not be music to the flesh ears, the ears of the flesh, but it is music to the ears of spirit. Absolutely it is. And that's what you really want. Trying to satisfy the senses of the flesh is not where it's at. It's obscene. It's absurd. It's unnecessary. So I can, I will, I have, take refuge in the condition-free condition. The condition-free condition. We're still going. That's nice. It's giving us full rein here. Maybe it'll keep going. I doubt it. It will click off pretty soon here. So greatly appreciate all viewership. It's awesome. Just experiencing the intensity of this is awesome. You know, it will be beneficial. It will be beneficial to you. It will. Familiarity is a gradual thing, you know, gradually. Try to go as fast as possible, but still, you know, tomorrow's another day. Another opportunity to get even more familiar. High spiritual culture. Apostolic culture. Apostolic culture is what we're about right now. So, as apostle of Jesus, I'm speaking up, bringing a little flavor, a little breeze of this apostolic culture, so you can say hi.